Good evening, everyone. This meeting of the Anderson Township Board of Zoning Appeals is hereby called to order. This board was established pursuant to Section 519.13 of the Ohio Revised Code by the Anderson Township trustees to provide administrative relief to any person or entity adversely affected by the Anderson Township zoning resolution. Will the secretary please call the roll?
Fred Hayes.
Here.
Steve Haber.
Here.
Paul Simon.
Here.
And Jan Mazel.
Here. Thank you. And thank you for coming to this meeting of the Anderson Township Board of Zoning Appeals. Please be aware that this meeting is audio and videotaped and may be carried on live television. First, I'll outline our procedures. A summary of the appeal is presented by the staff, then the appellant will present its case. The board members may then ask questions of the appellant. After that, all persons supporting the appeal will be permitted to testify, one at a time, after being recognized by the chair. When those persons supporting the appeal are finished, those opposed to the appeal will then be permitted to testify and/or ask questions of the board after being recognized by the chair. All persons wishing to testify, whether for or against an appeal, may only do so after being sworn in. When testifying, each person must come forward to the podium, either podium.
One podium.
After being recognized. That's come to the podium after being recognized. Speak into the microphone and state their name, address, and any affiliation to the case. All persons testifying will be limited to 4 minutes unless a board member requests additional time. All testimony is to be given to the board only. No comments or questions are to be directed to the appellant or anyone else in the audience. The board will only hear new, non-repetitive evidence or questions. Should someone wish to show support of previous testimony, they may do so by following the testimony procedures and stating their support of the previous testimony. Now, will all persons who may give testimony this evening please stand, raise your right hand. If you're in doubt, go ahead and stand. Raise your right hand and swear or affirm, do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Thank you. Are there any changes to tonight's agenda?
No.
I have one administrative technicality. We are missing our normal secretary, so I hereby appoint Mr. Haber as the secretary for this evening.
Okay. Will do.
Thank you. Let's proceed to case 8-2016-BZA. We have the staff's report, please.
Thank you. The applicant is Robert and Jill Storr, who are the property owners. The address is at 655 Nordyke Road, and the zoning there is AA residence, which is single-family residence. There are two requests for this application. One is a variance request for the height of a fence, 6 feet tall and solid in the front yard area, for a maximum of 4 feet tall and 75% open is permitted. This is per Article 5.2A9. And then request B is a variance to allow for an existing accessory structure to remain in the front yard area where it is required to be located or permitted to be located in the rear yard only. The tract size is approximately 4 acres and there's 20 feet of frontage on Nordyke Road. The topography is somewhat flat in the front and then it's rolling toward the rear of the property and the existing use is a single family residence. This is an aerial and also a zoning map of the properties in, surrounding the lot. I outlined in red is the site in question, and as you can see, it is a panhandle lot. All of the surrounding property is zoned AA, which is single family residence, and the property directly, I can give it the property directly to the south of this is owned by Hamilton County Park District and is used as a maintenance garage for the park property. The house itself was issued a zoning certificate in 2002, and at that time, There was an existing accessory structure on the property, and due to the construction of the home, it made the other structure illegal essentially, and it was noted on the zoning certificate that the structure should be removed or shall be removed. At the time, and the, it's a little small, but this is the area, and this is the actual zoning certificate from 2002. So these are staff's notes from the issuance of the zoning certificate, but this was the accessory structure here, the barn that was to be removed once the construction of the new home. And there was also an existing privacy fence located, again, in what is considered the front yard area on this property because of the panhandle nature of the property, and that fence was to screen the Park District's maintenance building and storage area. So these are some of the site photos. This is looking in the area of the storage shed, the Hamilton County Park District's Great Parks maintenance building. And the next slide shows the garage or the accessory building that was to be removed. These other site photos are looking toward the property from Nordyke Road, and then the other just vicinity pictures. So how this was brought to our attention, the fence that was in the front yard fell down, and the property owner came in to inquire about replacing it. It was determined by the Park District that that was not on their property, that it was actually on the store's property. So they aided in removing the fence and grading the property, but they requested the stores to come in to get a permit to replace the fence. So when we pulled the zoning certificate to figure out, you know, if it was on their property or was not on the property, that's when we noticed that the accessory structure was still located on the property. And this had nothing to do with the current owners. It was the previous owners. Those were the ones that were supposed to remove the structure. They were able to get occupancy of the house without removing the structure, and that's what brought this to our attention again. So we requested that the property owners, if they move forward the fence, also, you know, try to proceed with the variance for the garage as well. So the findings, staff's findings for these, staff finds that the variance is not substantial as the fence, and we broke this down into separate requests, but they are similar findings. The fence itself is located approximately 400 feet from the Nordyke, so it is not visible from the front yard area, and it's not visible from Nordyke. The character of the neighborhood would not be altered. The fence was there. It does serve a purpose to screen the maintenance facility of Great Parks. It will not affect delivery of governmental services, and they do have existing landscaping to screen, but it is not sufficient enough to screen the entire Great Parks area. The request B is for the to leave the barn or the accessory structure as is. And again, it was an existing condition that they bought into and were unaware of. The garage itself is located over 500 feet from Nordyke Road. It sits behind another house that fronts on Nordyke Road. So, and that house in particular also has an accessory structure. And actually, the accessory structures are in a similar location. So it doesn't impact the character of the area. The property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some other method. It would require demolition or to move the structure. And staff feels that the spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
In the interest of full disclosure of potential conflict of interest, I should disclose that I live close to this property. I was on the distribution list of notification of this hearing, but I never knew of the fence, and I never knew of the accessory structure. So I think that I can rule without bias, but if you are uncomfortable in any way, I will recuse myself.
No, I'm good.
Okay.
I'm good.
Thank you.
Yep.
Questions of staff?
No questions.
None? Would the appellant please come forward and present their case?
Oh, my.
Yeah, Robert M. Storr, 655 Nordyke Road. I'm the homeowner.
I thought Mr. Drury did a good job of explaining the situation, and would just like to reiterate that we were unaware that the previous owner had not applied for the variance. And if we look at alternative options, it was just going to be significant financial strain to have to demo it, and then again, that was really taken into consideration when we purchased the home as well, just having that extra detached garage. So would appreciate the consideration, happy to answer any questions.
Questions of the appellant?
No questions.
I do have one. The planned construction of the fence, you have the location in the application materials, but there's not a plan for what the fence would look like. What color is it? Is it going to be essentially the same?
Yes, it'll just be a 6-foot standard privacy fence, like dog-eared at the top, just standard wood.
So it won't be the same as what was?
No, that, from my understanding, that's what was there before, a 6-foot privacy fence.
It was 6-foot, but it was it was not dog-eared. It was ornate at the top, as best I can tell. But your plan is to have a straight?
Yeah, nothing fancy to it, nothing higher than 6-foot.
And in that location as,
yes,
as submitted?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Hayes, I'm going to follow on that question. There's more fence beyond the two extremes of what you're planning for? There's existing fence? Is that correct?
We have no other fence. The Park District, as you go further up, has fencing that runs more parallel with the road to prevent, they lock it up so people okay. cannot get in at night, but they do not have any fence that runs parallel to Nordyke in that particular area.
Okay, so this is the full extent of your fence?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, we have no other fence.
Perfect, thank you. Yeah. I just wanted to see if there was something to match or, you know, to go along with what you were talking about.
Yeah, that matched my understanding, is that there is no other fences along there.
Perfect.
Any other questions of the appellant?
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll now take testimony from those persons who support the appeal. Anyone? Seeing none, we'll take testimony from those who oppose the appeal. Seeing none, does the board have any further questions or thoughts before we close the public hearing on this case?
I do not.
No questions.
No. Seeing none, I'll close the public portion of the meeting for case number 8-2016 BZA. Proceeding on, the staff please present the report for case 9.
Sure, the applicant is Michael Mouch. He's from RWA Architects, and on behalf of Coldstream Country Club, who's the property owner. The location is at 400 Asbury on both sides of Asbury, and the zoning there is AA residence. The request is for the construction of a pool area within the 100-foot setback requirement per Article 3.1E4, as well as a conditional use request. And we've broken the staff report down into three separate items, request A, B, and C, and we'll go over those individually. The country club itself is a conditional use, which means that it is permitted in a single-family zoning district under certain conditions. And again, we'll outline those in the staff report or the presentation. The aerial, this is Asbury and Ayers. The clubhouse and the golf course is on both sides of Asbury, obviously. There are three different requests. Request A is for reconfiguration of the pool area. This is the pool area here. Currently, there's a separate diving well. So the pool area will be reconstructed into one pool that will be connected. Also, reconstruction of the kiddie pool and a shade structure. And we're calling that request A in the staff report. The second part of the request is to replace a hard court and tennis court into three paddle tennis courts. And this is located right in that area, again, on the same side as the pool house and the pool facility. And then the third request is for an indoor training facility for the driving range, which would be located on the east side of Asbury, off the parking lot and near the tennis courts on that side of the roadway. All of the surrounding property is zoned AA, except for the northern area, which is zoned A. All those are single-family zoning districts. We'll go to the next slide so you can see a little bit better the proposal. And we'll get to the history real quick. The Country Club itself was established in 1960, and it's been before the Board of Zoning Appeals four times. The first allowed for the construction of the pool building within the 100-foot setback. The second and the third allowed for the construction of other additional buildings within the 100-foot setback requirement. And then the last, most recently in 2010, allowed for the construction of two stone entry columns. So again, back to the request, this is Asbury and this is Ayers. We'll go to the next. Those are the existing conditions and the topography. This is the proposed site plan. This is the proposed reconfiguration of the pool, as well as the kiddie pool and shade structure. The 100-foot setback line, which is this dashed line on the slide, you can see the encroachment into that area. And you can also see the encroachment of the existing pool house into that 100-foot setback. Again, the second request is for the paddle tennis courts. There is no variance request for that. It is set back the required 100-foot. And then the indoor training facility, this is the outline, and it's also set back 100-foot. So there's no variance request for that. Just zoomed in areas of the site plan. This is the elevation drawing for the indoor practice facility. Again, the architecture is to match the existing clubhouse and other buildings on the property. And then these are some of the site photos. The first photo is looking south on Asbury toward the pool house, and the clubhouse is on the other side. This is standing near the intersection of, west on Ayers, looking down at the site of the basketball courts, the playground, and the pool. This is standing on Asbury, looking generally west down Ayers at the pool. Looking at the tennis court that would be replaced with three paddle tennis courts. This is the area that the proposed indoor training facility would be located. These are the tennis courts just off of the parking lot. And we did have some pictures that were submitted by the applicant, and I'll let the applicant go through their pictures. So to follow along in the staff report, there were three conditional uses in the zoning resolution that we were following: country clubs, swimming and tennis clubs, and golf course. The conditional uses or the specific conditions are outlined after those in the staff report, and those are labeled by letters. And we go through the staff report, and the applicant also presented their application with those conditions and how they were meeting those specific conditions. All three of these uses, the conditions overlap, so we only went through each one once. But the way that the staff report is written is whether we felt that the application was compliant or not compliant, and reasons being. So we'll just really skim over the compliant ones. The minimum site of 20 acres is compliant. Item D, structure shall be set back 100 feet. So the variance is being requested for the pool at a setback of 90 feet. And then the kiddie pool shade structure is located at 79.49 feet. Setbacks from adjacent residential property line shall be a minimum of 50 feet for all buildings. Structures are compliant, and then there are no changes for the parking area. The parking area is within that front yard setback and does not comply with the current standards, but it is not conforming and is not proposed to change. Again, the F identifies parking should not be in the front yard area, and the parking is not changing. Item G, they are compliant with access to Collector or Arterial Street. H, there are no changes to the vehicular use area. I, drop-off area, no changes again to that. Item L, measures shall be taken to minimize the impact of potential nuisances such as noise, odor, vibration, and dust on adjacent property. And we put in our staff report that we feel that more information is needed from the applicant, specifically on noise, not necessarily odor, vibration, or dust on adjacent properties, but noise from the paddle tennis courts. The pool has been in existence and is in the same location, so we don't think pool noise will be any more than it currently is, but paddle tennis is a new item that's not currently there. And again, the indoor training facility is indoor, is enclosed, they will open the garage doors, but the open area will be toward the driving range, not toward adjacent residential property. So we didn't feel that that is necessarily a factor, but we felt that more information should be provided for the paddle tennis courts. Item N speaks to the architectural design of the structures. And again, as you saw from the elevation drawing, the only structure beyond the paddle tennis is the indoor training facility and is of a character of the existing buildings on the site. There is one fence that's on the site plan. We think it's chain link to match the other fences around the pool, but it wasn't noted on the plan. A landscaping buffer, the applicants are proposing to use existing landscaping. No additional signage. Compliant with items Q, R, S is all exterior lighting shall be directed away from adjacent residential properties, and we feel that more information is needed from the applicant on that, specifically the paddle tennis. That's where the new lights are being introduced. Security measures, we feel that they are compliant. The applicant said that the general manager is who should be called if security issues arise. Meals shall be served only to guests. There's no change in the operation of the country club concerning meals. And why, the intensity of the particular use should be evaluated with regard to location, size, and configuration of the track. We feel that more information is needed specifically about the paddle tennis, but again, the pool is existing and the indoor training facility was still is subordinate to the overall golf course. As far as the variance for the pool, staff is of the opinion that the variance request is not substantial, as other variances within that 100-foot setback have been granted previously by this board. In addition, the proposed setback is actually greater than the existing setback of the structures there on site. The property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated by moving the structures outside of that 100 feet because they are trying to work with existing structures around the pool. And staff feels that the spirit intent behind the zoning requirement would be met. Again, the pool is over 50 years old and upgraded in the same general location and actually set back farther than what its current location is. So I'd be happy to answer any questions or explain the conditional use criteria if you have questions.
Before questions, I want to make a comment that that's the most thorough and detailed review of the various requirements for conditional use that I have seen on my experience here on this board. So I want to congratulate you and thank you on that work. Beyond that, questions of staff?
I have no questions.
No questions.
You may not know this, Paul, but do we know what time the current tennis courts are closed down at night?
I don't know that.
Okay, maybe the appellate knows. Because it seems like we've got some communication from residents that are concerned about that. So you're talking about noise and lighting and seeing what those concerns may be and perhaps how the designers might be able to alleviate that.
Correct.
Get you more information.
Correct.
Okay. Okay, cool. I'm good.
No other questions from staff, for staff? I have one. You know, and you've detailed where you need more information. Do you have that specifically in terms of average noise levels and by what times? Does the appellant know what they need to do?
So my discussion with the appellant is that the conditional use criteria, you know, will vary per site, obviously, and per the use, you know. So it's really up to them to demonstrate what they feel that the impact of the noise would be and how that may impact the adjoining residents and, you know, help provide that information to the board so that you can determine whether that does actually create a nuisance or it does not create a nuisance. So there's no specific standard as to, say, a decibel level at a property line or any of that nature. It's really for them to determine what they feel that the impact of the noise would be and for you to decide if that's a nuisance. As far as the lighting levels, the guidance that I've given them, really the only standard we have in the zoning resolution is for parking lot lighting. And in residential areas, we require 0.1 foot candles at the property line, which is about the illumination of a full moon. Actually, a full moon's a little bit brighter than 0.1 foot candles. So that's the guide that I've given them, the guidance that we've given them. The criteria for the conditional use is that it shall be shielded or directed away from residential properties, but it doesn't give a specific foot candle. So that's the discussion.
And we would keep with that 0.1 foot candles at the property line as the standard there. Mm-hmm. And the noise is more judgmental.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Would the appellant please come forward and present the case?
Thank you. My name is Mike Malk. I'm with RWA Architects. If it's all right with the BZA, I'd sort of like to co-present this with Kevin Osterfeld. He's going to sort of lead the discussion, and I would provide support to questions that you all might have that I can answer. I would like to discuss, we do have some additional information that we'd like to present to you, and we also have some folks here who can answer some of your questions concerning noise and lighting and those kind of things that I think that it's sort of coming down to with the as far as asking for more information. If that's okay, I'll introduce Kevin here and let him get started.
Hi.
Hi.
Thanks for having us tonight. My name's Kevin Osterfeld, and I'm presenting on behalf of Coldstream. I'm a member there, and they asked me to do this for them this evening. In addition to myself, Peter Swick, who's the general manager of Coldstream, is here. Paul Kitzmiller with Core Resources, who is our general contractor, is here. Mike Malk, you just heard from, and Mark Keeby, I believe, our paddle tennis contractor, is here as well. So hopefully we've got our bases covered in terms of any questions that might pop up. While I'm thinking of it, I want to answer the first question as well as I can. In terms of the current hours of the tennis facility, there really aren't any because those courts are not currently lit. So it's just not been an issue. I think sundown is probably the best answer I can give you there. Quick background, I wasn't sure how to attack this. It's a little unique in this request A, request B, request C. So I'm just gonna try to kind of roll it out and follow that format that Paul kind of established. As I said, the course was built in 1959, the pool in 1960, the tennis courts in 1966. So they've been there a while. As you know, there's two sets of considerations. There's the 17 different criteria that we fell into because of the conditional use and where a country club and a swim club and a tennis club and all those things. There were 17 criteria there out of your code that we need to address. And then the seven specific conditions that are with any area variance. And so what I was gonna do is kind of walk through those. The 17 criteria under consideration, according to staff's report, and we agree with staff's report, 12 of those have already been met more or less. Either we're already compliant or it's existing. So I didn't want to waste your time talking about those. The rest of those, all come out of section 5.4 of your code. D is the 100-foot setback, excuse me. When we get to request A, I'll address that one. L is measures taken to reduce the impact of the nuisance. When we get to request B, I'll address that. N is talks about the architectural design and is the layout consistent with the neighborhood. That will be addressed when we talk about request C. S is the lighting directed away from adjacent properties. We'll also talk about that with request B, so I'm trying to wrap this up as nicely as I can. 5.4Y is the only one I'll address now, and it just talks about the intensity of the use and is that aligned with the character of the neighborhood. We feel like there's virtually no change in what we're doing. We've had a pool, we're replacing that pool. We've had golf practice facilities forever. We are putting a little building there, but it's way within the setback, and we don't think a big use. We've had tennis courts, six tennis courts there for, you know, 50 years, and we are replacing one of the tennis courts with paddle tennis courts, but it's very similar. So we feel like 5.4Y we've already gotten to. So I'll start with request A, if that's okay with the board.
It's fine.
Okay. Request A is about the variance for the encroachment within the setback, and that applies to the pool and the shade structure. And with those, and with the seven considerations that you have as a board for a variance to consider, numbers 1 and 7, and will the property yield a reasonable return is one of them, and did the owner purchase the property with knowledge of these restrictions? We don't feel like they're applicable, so I wasn't going to waste any time on those. The other 5, is it substantial? We agree with staff that it's not substantial. We're actually going to encroach less into the setback than we do today. We're able to pull the pool and those structures, some of those structures back some. So we feel like we're less encroaching, so we feel like it's not substantial. Again, the essential character of the neighborhood, we believe that just remains unchanged. There will be no impact on the delivery of government services. Can the predicament be feasibly obviated through some other method? One of the big things that they didn't touch on is that our heater and our pumps and all of the equipment that runs these big pools, we now have underground. There's a little walkway and you can go down underneath near the pool, which is really nice for the neighbors and for us because we don't hear it and we don't see it and we don't want to hear it or see it. But what it did is it limited kind of where we could shape the pool somewhat. And that's why we have any encroachment whatsoever, because we didn't want to have to bring those things up from underground. Finally, is the spirit and intent of the zoning code respected with what we're trying to do? And again, this is a 56-year-old pool that has been leaking for longer than I'm want to admit and just needs to be replaced. And we don't think that the practice building or the paddle tennis courts, none of that really violates the spirit and the intent of the code. Of the 4 remaining criteria of the 17 that we talked about, one of them I wanted to address here, which is 5.4D, requiring the 100-foot setback. And again, nothing changed there. I think we've addressed that. We'll be encroaching less in the future than we will today. So that kind of sums up request A. I don't know if you wanted me to stop with questions as we go or go right into B.
Preference from the board?
No preference.
No.
Lump it all together?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Request B. Paul, could you pull up the picture, the best picture you have of the tennis courts? They had one up there at one point I thought was really good. There, that's fine. Thank you. The request B is specific about the addition of the paddle tennis courts. We intend to add 3 courts, and it's a little difficult to tell, but where you see the blue tennis court, that's actually a hard surface tennis court. The next 3 beyond that are soft surface tennis courts. The paddle tennis courts as it stands today would go over the top of that first hard court. So those 3 soft courts would remain untouched and that hard court would be gone. It would become the 3 paddle tennis courts. Quickly, the reason we feel paddle tennis is important, there's a lot of demand for it. Over the last 10 or 15 years, certainly in this area, it has really exploded. We find ourselves in a very competitive environment, as you might guess, in terms of country clubs. We looked at every country club, at least on the east side of Cincinnati, Kenwood, Camargo, Cincinnati, High Park, Macatawa, all of them have paddle tennis courts. So this is not the least bit unusual. Every single one has paddle tennis, except for Terrace Park, who is in the process of putting them in. So in terms of the use, we think this keeps us competitive with what our peers are doing, and there's a lot of demand out there from our members for it. Another thing to note is once the paddle tennis courts are built, we're approximately 210 feet from the edge, the nearest edge of the paddle tennis court to the nearest property line that's not ours, to the nearest property line of any neighbor. I just want to make sure you're aware of that.
That's to the west?
That would be to the west, yeah, heading due west, correct. And then that location, I mean, we have 190 acres. There are various places we might have been able to put the courts. But it made sense for a lot of reasons. In terms of usefulness and in terms of economy, Paul, is there any way to get a look at where the pool house, can you see the pool house in one of your pictures? I guess we can, that's probably better right there. You can see the tennis courts there in the background on the top picture, and that is our pool house just to the left. The far right edge of that pool house is a screened-in porch. And so one of the things that is that comes with paddle tennis is basically what they call a warming hut, where people can go inside between matches while someone else is playing and obviously stay warm. Paddle is a cold weather sport. I mean, literally, sometimes it's played below zero. And so we would be able to take that screened-in porch. We'd have panels made that you could put in that would, and we'd heat it. That would, in turn, that would become our paddle, our warming hut. We also already have existing bathroom facilities in that building. So we have existing parking, obviously right smack out front. We have our existing racket sports right there. We're on top of, basically on top of the tennis courts. And therefore, with only very minor modifications in that position, we have everything we need. If we moved it elsewhere on the property, we're gonna have to put in a lot of those things. It makes it almost prohibitive cost-wise to add all those things. So it just makes a lot of sense to be right there. 5.4L is another one of the 17 criteria. It's the second of the remaining four that we need to address, which is what measures have we done, have we taken to minimize nuisance? And like Paul said, of the nuisances listed, I think noise is the one here that most people are concerned about. I met with staff and I asked staff the question, what can I tell the board? How do we minimize this noise nuisance? And basically what you heard from Paul is what I heard, which is kind of a tough call. It's a subjective thing. I can't give you a decibel readout or any such thing like that. I don't know how familiar any of you are personally with paddle tennis. The best I've heard, and I think our paddle tennis contractor would tell you if you ask him, the noise level is similar to tennis. I mean, maybe a hair louder or not quite as loud, but it's very similar to tennis. And so I did Google, by the way, quote unquote, paddle/platform tennis noise study. And if you, as you know, at the bottom of most of your Google searches, you'll have 20 or 30 or 40 pages of answers, less than a full page, and none of them really had anything to do with this. And the point is that, like our installer, who's installed hundreds of paddle tennis courts, it's never been enough of an issue that there's any been any big study we could just grab and show you. And we didn't want to, obviously, try to engage our own study. We do have existing heavy evergreen buffer immediately to the west of us. Paul, if you go back to the other tennis court picture, please. Not that one. Yeah, that's probably as good as we're going to get, I guess.
We have pictures that you provided.
Okay, I haven't actually seen those, but if could you roll up to those then? Okay, that's probably good. So that's standing roughly on the paddle tennis courts looking due west. So as you can see, there's pretty heavy screening there. I think the problem with the screening is most of the trees over to the right are evergreen. Most of the stuff near to the left or kind of in the middle is deciduous, and I'll address that in a moment. Last but not least, paddle tennis is a cold weather sport. It is designed, you almost can't play it in the summer. The ball gets too bouncy. If you look on the Greater Cincinnati Paddle Tennis Association site, I think their season starts in late October and wraps up, I'm not sure, February or March, something like that, but it's a winter sport. So because it's a winter sport, windows are likely to be closed. People aren't probably in January hanging out on the back deck or anything like that. So we think that goes towards the noise part of this. 5.4S, the third of the four remaining 17 criteria that we needed to meet, talks about lighting being directed away from the neighbors. Do we have handout? I got you. I was going to ask if I could submit this to the board. There's actually two photos here. Actually, I'm sorry, there's three. There's three things here I'd like to submit to the board, if I could, as evidence, Paul. The top picture is a photograph of a paddle tennis court in play, and it just speaks to the modern lighting and how good it is at being directed where you want it. If you look at that pathway to the right, right next to the court, you see how dark the pathway is that literally is right next to the court. and we will talk to you about lumens. We have a study to get in that. We wanted you to see that photograph. If you look at the next item that's folded up, this is a study that was done. You can see our three courts in the middle, and this gives you the number of lumens at various distances. You've got a scale over to the far left and on top. That scale is 150 feet. When you get out to approximately 120 feet, we get to zero lumens. Obviously, we're at point lumens even less than 120 feet out. So with the nearest neighboring property line being 210 feet, we get to zero lumens at 120 feet. And as Paul mentioned, 0.1 lumens is generally considered to be a little less bright than a full moon. So we feel like hopefully that is satisfies the board's concerns, or at least gives you enough information to draw a conclusion about in terms of the lighting. We did include on the next, the last couple of things, it's a photograph of the actual light fixture that we will use. It's an LED light. The pole is 20 feet high from the surface of the court. And those are all the specs related to it. It would be pointed straight down. The last thing I want to talk about in reference to both noise and lighting, if you look at the picture that's still up on the screen, you can see quite a hill to the west of us. A hill of similar height, maybe a little bit smaller, is to the south. There's a hill directly behind him as well. So I think Paul's term he used at one point when I was speaking to him is that this entire pool tennis area kind of sits in a bowl. And so that is another thing which obviously helps mitigate any concerns you might have with lighting. That is everything I had in terms of request B, so I'm happy to answer any questions if you have anything.
Questions of the appellant?
What time do you anticipate the paddle court closing during the when it's operating?
I will get to you more at that. We spoke to several of the neighbors who had pretty serious concerns, and they're actually, these neighbors are members of the club, and we wanted to satisfy them and the club as well. So we have kind of come to an agreement on a limitation of number of hours that I was going to give you at the end, if that's okay.
Okay.
It's part of a couple other agreements, so.
Do you know what kind of material the paddle court base is made of?
I would let our paddle consult or our paddle contractor answer that, if that's okay.
Sure. Come up.
Sure.
Was he sworn in?
Were you sworn in, sir, or did you come late?
I came late.
Would you raise your right hand and swear or affirm? Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Mark Keeby. I'm one of the owners of Total Platform Tennis. We're one of two platform tennis construction companies in the country. This is what we do full-time. We don't do other things. We do platform tennis. The court itself, the deck, and the superstructure that goes around it is a custom extruded aluminum extrusion. So the deck itself is an aluminum base. It's on aluminum I-beams, which are bolted to a concrete piers. So it's a very solid, it doesn't rattle. It's a very solid structure. Just as important, the sport is played, the ball that's used is a rubber ball with a flocking on it, so like a fuzzy cover to it. So it's not like a wiffle ball or a hard ball. The paddles themselves are made of a dense composite foam, so there's no wood in those either. So the sound coming off the paddle, the ball, and the deck is pretty much minimal. The screens that surround the court are a hex mesh galvanized steel, very similar to a chicken wire, a thick chicken wire. So, and they're stretched very tight, so there's no rattling of those screens either. It's actually a very quiet structure. Our company has been in existence 5 years. We've built over 120 courts. My business partner has been building for over 30 years. He's personally built over 400 courts at clubs around the country. And in no situation where a court is in a environment like this have we ever had, and I've been playing for about 30 years, have we ever had a complaint or a comment that, hey, we need to do something, our neighbors are complaining about the noise. It's never happened. we would have heard about it. They would have been to us saying, hey, what can we do to block the noise? And it's, the issue with the noise has never come up, but sorry for the long answer as to what the court's made of. It's aluminum.
What are the paddles made of?
The paddles are made of a dense foam, a composite foam with like a fiberglass face on them. Should have brought one in, but.
So in this picture, there's a couple things that I'm, if this is the actual paddle surface.
That's the court, correct.
And then what I see in the foreground is the chicken wire, you say, that then wraps the entire court area. Then what is this that is beyond here that you're showing in this picture?
It might have a windscreen. It is. It's a windscreen very similar to what you see on the tennis courts. That most likely will go up on the ends of the courts. The club put them up. It's not for wind, it's for visibility of the players, like a batter's eye in baseball, because in the wintertime, if you go all the way through to the trees, the yellow ball, as it loses its flocking, becomes darker, and it starts blending in with the background. But those windscreens will also serve, because they're relatively solid, as a light and noise block.
And how long, and how high does the fence go around the court?
The fence is 12 feet above the playing surface.
And how high is the light fixture?
The light fixtures are another 8 feet above that. So okay. It's 20 feet above the deck. The deck will sit 3.5 feet above grade. So the light fixtures above grade will be 23.5 feet. But again, to the point of the location of these courts, which is really good for that, it sits down in a bowl. So it will be down below the property lines.
Is the height of the fence regulated by rules and
yes,
regulations?
It
can only be 12 feet high.
That's correct. The American Platform Tennis Association regulates the dimensions
okay. And
look of the court, correct.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Sure. Other questions? Sir, I do have one.
Yeah, sure.
Quite familiar with complaints about new pickleball courts going in and the noise hazards or noise nuisance of those. Compare the noise level of paddle tennis to pickleball, if you can. Do you have any experience with pickleball?
I do, and I can tell you the reason pickleball is so much noisier. It's a plastic wiffle ball.
Yes.
And it's a solid wood paddle playing off of a asphalt surface, but it's mainly the paddle. The ball against the paddle that's clacking. The difference would be a commercial jet compared to a maybe not even a private jet. It's not even close. The pickleball is significantly noisier because of the ball and the paddle.
That's what I was suspicious of. Okay.
A doubt, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Sorry. One more question for you.
Sure.
It looks like you have switched out the light fixture. Is this a typical fixture you're using now for these courts? Because I saw more of a spotlight in one of the other.
That's correct. What you're seeing are what we call the metal halide fixtures with stadium-style reflectors like you see on mm-hmm. football stadiums, softball fields, things like that. Again, with my experience as a player and my partners as a builder, we tried to find as the players get older, vision goes down, and we were trying to perfect a light that was significantly better than what we have. The metal halide stadium style were really good, but the downside is you get a big ball of light up in the air, which is why we went to an engineering company who said we can design you LED fixtures that are better, and our requirements were right at the top. We need a fixture that has minimal light pollution. And the company that designed it, which is what you're seeing there, they designed it. You'll see it on a lot of auto dealerships, and you'll see them at convenience stores that have neighbors right there. And they had specifically already worked on a fixture that cuts off. So that's why we've gone to that. It's one of the reasons we've gone to that. And it's a horizontal fixture. With it being below where the neighbors are, they won't see the light source at all. They'll see a very bright court, but they're not going to see any one light pollution, and they're not going to see a light source up in the air shining in, and that's one of the main reasons we went away from the metal halides.
Okay. One more question. How many lights, what kind of night operation do you have now at the pool? Do you have night pool parties there at all now? Or
on a rare occasion, I I'm a little afraid to answer that one too much, but if anyone back there hears me and I get way off guard, way off course here, but on a rare occasion, there is a pool parties, probably a handful of times a year that there are parties out there. But to say that there's craziness going well after hours has not happened. Nothing's lit. The pool's not lit. The tennis isn't lit currently.
Yeah, that was my question.
Yeah. And I did want to mention, in terms of the pickleball, for what it's worth, pickleball can be played on either paddle or tennis courts. I've never played it. That's my understanding. And we actually have pickleball today. It's not played much at Coldstream, but we do. It is there, and it is available, and the court is lined for it. So.
On the tennis courts, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. And you had no complaints about the pad?
Not to my knowledge.
Other questions?
What's that?
No more questions.
Go ahead.
I think Mr. Drury gave us some letters that some folks wrote in, I guess, or emailed to you. And reading through them, I think they might have had the wrong sport. They were talking about a wiffle ball, a perforated wiffle ball, and paddle. That's pickleball. This is, we're talking about platform tennis or paddle tennis, it's typically called. So I think that whoever sent that in there, that a lot of that discussion was not even about the sport we're talking about tonight. Thanks.
One other question from
you. Yes, sir.
What alternatives did you look at to try to construct the structures? I'm talking about the request A, to stay within the required setbacks.
You talked specifically about the pool.
The pool and the rest of the structures, including the shade canopy and the kiddie pool. What other alternatives did you look at that may have been compliant and still meet your restrictions on leaving the pool equipment right where it is?
I'd like to ask, I think Mr. Swick, the general manager, would probably be the best one to answer that, right, Peter? So if you could, if you would.
In regards to the pool.
State your name, please.
Peter Swick. In regards to the pool, we really didn't look at many other locations just because of the size of that underground cavity where the pumps, the filters, the chlorine and everything stored. There really wasn't another viable option where the pool runs north-south. If it continued to run north-south, but the other way, it would encroach actually on a tennis court. And so from a pool standpoint, it was really the only way for us to have one contiguous pool rather than having a lap pool and then having a dive well as well.
What restrictions would the separated facilities have? That's what you have now. Right. I'm looking for one of the things that we use in terms of judgment calls, right, is what's the hardship that the resident or the agency has? What are we really trying to judge against?
Right.
Help me understand what the hardship is.
Right. Well, the thought with doing just one pool is one of, for us and with the green space that we have within our pool complex, it frees up a little bit of space. But then, two, it allows us just to use one filter system and pump system since it's all just one unit. But it really does free up a little bit of green space for us around the pool, and that was really the driver. And it's much more efficient with the pumps and everything else.
Single system, single set of
systems. Yep.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions from the appellant, for the appellant?
I was going to do request C. I wanted to touch on that, too. If
we could. Sorry.
Okay.
Go.
Okay. And this was just talking about the practice building, and I think compared to request B, this is fairly simple. Paul, if you could put up quickly just the schematic or the elevations you had of that building. It was designed to look very much like our clubhouse as much as possible. The lower right, you see a couple of doors there that, you know, you open those up in the winter, it's heated inside, you hit from inside to the outside. The fourth of the four criteria that I've been speaking about, of the 17, and I needed to answer four more, is would the architectural design and layout of the structures and the location and the height of fences, et cetera, be compatible. We don't know how to make this any more compatible. I mean, it looks very much like it's been there since day one. It is well outside of any setback. In terms of fencing, and I think this went back to the pool area, kind of all got captured here, we're not making any changes to any fences. We have a fence all the way around the pool and the tennis, and that'll stay as is. So there's no change there. In terms of additional mitigation, you asked a moment ago about what else might have happened. We have talked with a couple of the neighbors most affected. I kind of felt like there were four neighbors that were most interested slash most affected. I personally spoke to each one of them. I noticed at least several of them are here tonight. The one immediately to the west, which is at the top of that hill nearby, and then one at the corner of Ayers and Asbury, one down Asbury a little bit. I think that's an Asbury address. One down Asbury a little bit, and then the one next, the first one up Ayers Road. At any rate, the four most immediately affected. What we've talked about in terms of lighting, to try to mitigate that as much as we can, in addition to the fixtures that you saw and all the other things that there are that mitigate the lighting, we have agreed that we would accept the condition that the board would put on this, that all court lighting is to be turned off no later than 10 p.m. Sunday through Thursday, no later than 11 p.m. Friday, Saturday, days before holidays, and holidays. And that is for as long as the current residents of 7552 Ayers remain, reside there. And so that would be one condition in terms of the lighting to try to mitigate that. Number two is that Coldstream will plant up to 10 evergreens. Now this is getting a little funny, but up to 10 evergreens up to 15 feet in height in places designated by the current owner of 7552 Ayers Road, which again is the neighbor immediately to the west along his east property line. I pointed out earlier that there's some concern if you looked at the hedge between us and him, there's a fair amount of deciduous kind of in the middle. And so the idea would be to fill the rest of that in. Timing, the pool, we have some urgency. We're obviously hoping very much we get an approval tonight. If we're able to get an approval tonight, according to our contractors, we got a better than even chance of having it open by Memorial Day next year. If we wait another month, all bets are off. Modest urgency, I guess, to the paddle. If we're able to get that approved tonight, we can get most of the season in this year. Again, the season starts in a couple months. We'd like as much of the season as possible for the paddle. Frankly, there's no urgency to the golf building, the practice building. In fact, we were going to ask, I assume it's still the habit of the board to say that as a condition, this must start within 1 year and be completed within 2 years. If that's the case, we would ask that you consider that this be started within 2 years and completed within three, because that practice facility, there is some question as to exactly where to put it, and we know that may mean we might have to come back if it moves, but exactly where to put it, and there are some other issues with the greater practice facility, so we don't anticipate that be built real quickly. It could be more than a year from now before that gets started, so that's the reason for that request. And I did want to mention in closing that you know, I think Coldstream feels one regret within this whole process, which is prior to starting all of this, no one from Coldstream reached out to any of the neighbors. And you know, that was just an oversight on our part, and it wasn't handled the way it should have been. And you know, as a club, we regret that happened. We've tried to make up for it as quickly as we can, but I think that they feel slighted, and I think they probably should have felt slighted. And so, you know, as a club, we're sorry that came to that, and we wish it hadn't been that way. And with that, I'm happy to take any more questions or
more questions.
The evergreens you mentioned you were going to put in, how tall would they?
Max 15 feet.
Up to 15 feet. Yeah. Yeah. Pretty big.
Other questions? Yeah. One quick question. I want to make sure that I understood the fencing. There is no additional fencing going anywhere. I thought that there was, and we had a question about that, I think.
No, I don't believe there is.
None. Okay, so the question about the style of the fence is not, is moot?
I don't believe so.
There is none. Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Are there anyone that wishes to speak in favor of this request? State your name and address, sir, and then give your testimony.
My name is Ken Berry. I live, I'm property owner just to the west of this proposed change. I have been I've had a problem with this whole process from the beginning, and I've discussed this many times with the people involved at Coldstream, and we've come to a conclusion that the light and the noises are my big issue. They have agreed to plant some trees to mitigate the light and hopefully help with noise. We agreed upon a moratorium or a curfew, which I think will eliminate the noise issue, especially at night. There's one concern that just cropped up that I would like to address. I wouldn't be up here because apparently all my issues have been discussed. You mentioned pickleball. Pickleball is a loud sport, and pickleball can be played on the platform courts. And the nature of pickleball is a loud sport, and on top of those platform courts, it gets very loud. And I would like to make a stipulation, if that's possible, that pickleball not be played on the platform courts. It can be played on the existing tennis courts that's already marked off for them, but I'd like to keep the pickleball off the platform courts, again, from a noise standpoint. Other than that, I'm okay with the lighting issue and the noise issue as long as the curfews are imposed and the trees are planted. Other than that, I'm good to go with this. Okay, thanks.
Sir, excuse me, your address, please?
7552 Ayers.
Thank you.
The first house to the west.
Thank you so much.
Other questions? Sir, I do have a question. You do agree with the 10 p.m. on weekdays and the 11 p.m. on Friday and Saturday night?
Yes, those were my idea. It was either that or build the courts without lights. That's not feasible. So the curfew works for us.
Okay. And then with those stipulations, you're in favor of this?
Yeah, I'm fine with it.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else would like to speak in favor of this request? Or any of the three requests? Seeing none, is there anyone that wishes to speak against this?
I'm Pat Tonsman, 321 Asbury, directly across from the driving range. I feel somewhat surprised here because I've been deceived about what was going to be presented here today. That being that the golf facility, I have no problem with the golf facility at all. Matter of fact, I'm for it. I'm for that. But they have no lighting at all. We don't have any lighting at all. I think noise and lighting is a big concern of mine. It's a concern, obviously, of what the main proposal here and the problem is with this about the racquetball or paddle tennis court. But I have to say that it's a comment here made by the presenters that there is no problem with the noise in that situation. There are hundreds of lawsuits from Connecticut to Washington State to Florida about paddle tennis courts and pickleball courts, and it's the noise and the lighting. Thank you.
Questions of
this? And that is very easily obtained on the internet.
No questions.
Mm-hmm. Thank
questions?
You.
Thank you, sir. Anyone else wish to speak in against this action?
Yes. I am Penelope Thompson. Have lived lived in our home with my husband for 44 years.
Your address, ma'am?
Penelope Thompson.
You know your address?
1 Asbury Road. We have had paddle tennis courts at Coldstream, 500 feet to the east of our home, and that was back by the Skeet House, which was a very excellent placement for the paddle tennis courts. It had access from Ayers Road East. It has parking. It has electricity. It has a potential for movement in and out, since they are going to be serving food, alcoholic beverages, etc. But I wanted you to consider that we, living in our home at 321 Asbury Road, heard paddle tennis day and night from our home 500 yards or so away. So I want you gentlemen to understand that paddle tennis is a raucous, boisterous sport. I have played it. It's not the quiet gentleman's game of tennis. And this being introduced into a neighborhood of homes whereby there are working parents, students going to school, getting up at 5 and 6 a.m. in the morning, going to school, parents perhaps getting up at 5 and 6 a.m. going to school in the morning, and I'm hearing at 10 o'clock at night they'll be closing weeknights. This is weeknights, closing down the paddle tennis courts, 11 o'clock on weekends. However, if you parents would consider the fact that 10 p.m. is a little late for raucous play on a neighborhood paddle tennis court situation, I think you would understand why 10 p.m. is an excessive time for closing. 11 o'clock is okay for weekends, that's fine. But I think you need to consider the neighborhood, because this is being put now in a residential situation. Prior, 20 years ago, when paddle tennis was at Coldstream, it was put way back by the Skeet House. So there is an introduction here of a loud sport, not a quiet tennis gentleman sport. And I think that needs to be considered in your decision making, please. Thank you.
Questions of this person?
No questions.
No? Thank you, ma'am. Others wishing to give testimony against this action? Seeing none, would the appellant like to give further testimony, rebuttal?
Yeah, thank you. Couple things. Again, Kevin Osterfeld. Couple things. I would ask, and I'm not sure if this is okay, because this actually hasn't come up in terms of the pickleball, but whether or not that, if that's an issue with pickleball being played, that perhaps we allow pickleball to at least being played during daylight hours. So in other words, you couldn't play pickleball under the lights, so there'd be no concern that it would be played late in the evening. And I'll let perhaps some of the other parties address that, but that was just a thought. In terms of...
Clarifying that,
yes, sir.
The requested restriction was that pickleball never be played on the paddle tennis platforms. The tennis courts, which is where pickleball would be played, are not lit. Do I understand that right?
That's correct. That might work fine.
So that'd be fine.
I've never played pickleball. I'm not very familiar with it. So, but yeah, that would probably be fine.
Well, okay. Under lighting conditions, they'll go all night. But you're not going to light the tennis courts. And if we restricted it to pickleball only on the tennis courts, then there wouldn't be a problem.
That's a good point. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay.
That makes sense. Okay.
Thank you.
In terms of putting the paddle tennis where Mrs. Thompson spoke that it was many years ago, there are a number of problems with that. The first is it would be in the middle of our future golf practice facilities. Obviously, we can't have it there. In addition, there isn't enough parking. We'd have to build new parking there. For instance, we had paddle tennis down there before. There's a building there, but it's a very small building that faces the other direction and is used for skeet. And so it would not work. We'd have to build a new building. There are no bathrooms down there. There is no water down there. There is electric, that's it. So the cost would be prohibitive for us to put them down there, number one, and number two would be in the middle of our practice facilities. And then in, the last thing, as you mentioned, in terms of restricting hours further during the week, that would, I think for all intents and purposes, would not allow us to have league play. League play oftentimes goes after 9 p.m. By and large, I think mostly it starts around 7 or 7:30, wraps up around 9 or 9:30, but that doesn't mean a match can't run long and go a little longer. So we very much want to keep the 10 p.m. Monday through Thursday.
Questions of Mr. Osterfeld?
No questions.
Okay, thank you. Are there any further questions from the board to anyone?
No questions.
I have none.
Okay. Hearing no further comments, if there's no objection from the board, I'll close this public hearing on case number 9-2016 BZA. I should clarify that our normal procedures here is that we will listen to the public hearing of every case, and then after all of those are done, then the board will start debating case by case. So, and if we can reach a conclusion at that time. So that will come later. Right now we'll proceed to the public hearing of case number 10-BZA. The staff present the case, please.
The property is Louis Bang, who's the property owner. The location is at 8008 State Road, and the zoning there is B, single family. This is a variance request to keep a crushed limestone driveway where solid surface is required per Article 5.3D7A. The tract size is 3.4 acres. There's approximately 272 feet of frontage on State. The topography is somewhat flat, and the use is a single family residence. The surrounding properties are all single family, and the zoning of all the surrounding properties is also single family. This is an aerial of the site in question. A little bit of history as well on this one. A zoning certificate was issued in August of 2014 for the construction of a new home. This home replaced an over 100-year-old farmhouse that was on the property. There is currently an existing barn on the property as well, and the property is still used for some small agricultural use. And just so you have your bearings, this is State Road here, and this is Nagel Middle School. As stated, the original zoning certificate for the replacement for the new home was issued in 2014. This was the site plan that was approved for this particular application. The surface of the driveway was not noted on the plan. It was implied by staff that this would be paved, as it is a requirement for all new homes, or even if there's a substantial modification on a property, that the driveway be a hard dust-free surface, whether it's concrete, whether it's asphalt, or some other material that qualifies as a hard dust-free surface. So this was the original zoning certificate. We had a revision that came through. The original zoning certificate was for the home and also a detached garage. Then there was a revision to this zoning certificate that came in June of 2015, and in lieu of building a detached garage, the proposal was for an addition for an attached garage. And so you can see this is the site plan that was submitted and approved at that time as well. Again, the surface of the driveway was not noted on either of the plans. So we'll go through the site photos again. This is the driveway. It was the existing driveway to the former home that was on the property. It was gravel at the time. And it was considered a non-conforming driveway because the driveway was there prior to zoning being in place. This gives you an idea. The driveway comes in and curves over to the right to the garage attached to the new house. The barn is off in the distance, a close-up view of the home. And then this is a picture of the back of the property where there is an existing barn and existing greenhouse on the property. And the gravel does extend to the barn. The top photo was the existing home, just to get your bearings. This was taken from the auditor's website. The existing home, or the original home, did have a garage in the back, and that's where the gravel driveway did go to. This is the new home that's currently there. So we'll go back to the site, the current site plan. This was brought to the homeowner's attention when they were trying to receive occupancy from the building department. So the building department, in residential cases, they are the ones that are inspecting the property for the township and in compliance with both zoning and building codes. When they were giving temporary occupancy of the home, it was noted that the driveway was still gravel, and it was brought to their attention by the Hamilton County Building Inspector that the driveway must be paved. So we met with the property owner and we discussed it, and there was a misunderstanding that since the driveway was existing, they felt that the driveway could remain as gravel, and we explained that no, all new construction is required to be paved. So there was this disagreement with that. So in preparing the application, we encouraged the applicant to first state the reasons for appeal, but also to go beyond that as well with the request to keep the driveway gravel. So the staff report is written as a variance request. Regardless of the appeal, whether you agree or disagree, if it needs to be gravel, we would suggest that you go ahead and grant, you know, a variance. If you agree that it should remain gravel, that a variance is granted for that. As far as our findings, staff's position is that a variance is substantial, that although the driveway had been gravel for over 100 years, that all new construction is required to be a hard dust resurface, and we couldn't distinguish this new home from any other new homes in the township. The character of the neighborhood may or may not. There is a mixture of old homes and new homes on this street. In particular, there are older homes across the street. Most have paved driveways. There may be one or two on state that have gravel. There was a new home constructed more recently just to the east, I'm sorry, to the west of this property, and their driveway is paved as well. So as far as the character of the area, there is a mixture of different surfaces in the area. As far as the predicament of the property owner, we feel that it can easily be paved, although it may be expensive. It is something that's can be made conforming. And the spirit intent behind the zoning requirement, we feel that leaving it gravel is not within the spirit intent of the current requirements that all driveways be paved for new structures. So I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Questions or staff?
As a part of the design and review process for the new home, was the original driveway relocated, or is it the same driveway in the same location?
It's the same driveway in the same location.
Okay. So what we're saying is had the original house, farmhouse, been there, and it not be because of the new construction of the new home, that the gravel driveway would have been able to remain?
Correct. The original home was built prior to zoning regulations being in effect.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore the driveway was not conforming and was allowed to remain.
Right.
With a new construction of a new home, zoning regulations require the driveway to come into conformance and okay. be paved.
Okay.
Same as, and this is staff's interpretation. We have other gravel driveways out there, two homes. They choose to build a detached garage. We would require that gravel driveway to be paved to the detached garage. Mm-hmm. Or if they had a substantial addition onto their home, we would require that pave the driveway to come into compliance.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions?
I have no questions.
It looks like in some of the photos, and I think I read in the letter, that there's a proposal to keep some of the gravel that goes to the barn also.
Correct.
Is that something that, should this move forward, that can be paved, but that gravel can stay, or does that need to be then paved also?
Yes, with this drawing, we interpret this as being a different surface than what was there as gravel. It appeared to us, just by the looks of this drawing, that it would be hard surface, although it wasn't noted. So I guess that was an assumption on our part. The existing surface, and it goes to an existing barn, so we would not have required that area to be paved. The improvement was really to the house. But that is also a part of their request. I asked the applicant to just put everything on their site plan if they wanted to leave the driveway gravel and also, you know, leave it gravel back to the barn.
Mm-hmm. I have one question, Paul. As I reviewed this in preparation for this meeting, I also took a look at effective dates of our zoning resolution, revisions to the zoning resolution, and the application, the second application here. Am I correct in assessing that even the revised zoning resolution, and there may have been some revisions to this section, it predated this second zoning certificate?
Yeah, I'm not aware that this requirement has changed since zoning has been implemented in the township.
I couldn't tell, but even if that was possible,
since 1988.
Even if that was possible, though, the latest zoning resolution was approved and available at least a few months before this second zoning certificate. Okay, thank you. And the complaint arose from the final inspection, which the township didn't do. That was from Hamilton County.
Well, Hamilton County is the one that inspects residential properties, so they would be the one to notify the township that a zoning requirement. They wouldn't allow for final occupancy until the zoning requirements have been met as well. So that,
okay.
They are the inspector for the township and for residential property.
And they didn't see any problem with this zoning certificate. They didn't see the potential assumption of leaving it gravel. They saw it as not meeting the zoning resolution.
Correct.
Yep. Thank you. If there's no other questions for staff, would the appellant please come and present your case?
I'm Lou Vang, and I live at 8008 State Road. I acquired this property from my dad, and the house in question, the old house, and I'm glad you had pictures of the old house, was an old farmhouse, and it had just outlived its usefulness as a residence. So we elected to deconstruct that and build a new house on there. As you can see from the old picture, we did our best to keep the new house to look similar to the old one, yeah, as far as color, materials, although it's a newer design, but the windows are very similar as far as the glass panes. It's 2/2. Doors we tried to keep similar. The materials of the house are similar. The old house was asbestos siding, which is no longer available, so we went with a fiber cement siding rather than vinyl to, you know, just kind of keep things as close as we could for the character of the properties. It's like I said, and I need to go go through all this?
It's your call, sir.
Okay.
Whatever you want.
I don't want to waste your time, but it was an old farm, one of the last in the township, mm-hmm. and we tried to preserve, you know, the character of it. I never even considered the driveway, to be honest with you. Never gave it a thought. And when I never built a house before either, so this was all new to me. The surveyor came out, you know, did all his measurements and stuff, and he drew up the site plan, I think he did, and it said drive. It said concrete surface from the road to the sidewalk, and concrete sidewalk. And I just assumed that we would make it, when it said drive, just the same drive, leave it as is. Never considered or thought it had been hard surface. And we went through this whole process, you know, building the house, and on final inspection, said, oh, it has to be hard surface. Well, that presents several problems. One is, if I'd have known that ahead of time, I'd have probably put the garages on the front of the house, because that driveway is 200 foot long. We'd have changed the driveway. Now I have no place to park. We didn't live there at the time of construction. Now you pour concrete, it has to wait at least 7 days to drive on it, so you have to have a place to park. Also, the cost. It cost quite a bit just to get the limestone there spread, leveled out and everything, do the damage from the construction trucks. Now, if I have to pave it, you know, I have to get rid of the limestone to start with, plus the cost of, you know, the resurfacing of it. I also included is a letter from the builder, who is the architect also. We were all totally unaware of the zoning that it had to be. So I don't know, you know, what else. Although I think you brought up a good point. If I do have to have it hard surfaced, can I leave from the end of the house or end of the garage to the barn? Can I leave it as a limestone? Because that all that is just to keep my tractors and equipment out of the mud. And when I see equipment tractors, it's all for personal use. It's not commercial or anything. It's just to keep the residents looking good and tidy.
Questions of the appellant? I have one, sir.
Yes, sir.
I understand. I've read all of what you've submitted.
Mm-hmm.
Removal and starting over, if you were to concrete it, I don't think that you would have to do that if you were to put asphalt over it. You could leave that as the base and asphalt over it. Is that not part of your consideration? Would you completely go with concrete and that's the only choice?
I have mixed emotions on that. I would prefer concrete, although it's more expensive and takes quite a while. Blacktop or asphalt is just a maintenance nightmare sometimes. It's tacky, you always have to seal it, have it worked on all the time. So it's a consideration, yes, sir, but a second choice. The other thing I would like to bring up, and I'm a novice at this, so please keep that in mind. I looked in the township under single family homes. It defined how tall it can be, how far set back from the property lines, etc. Nothing at all about the driveways, which I would have assumed logically, that's where I thought I would have found it. I also found something, as it's in there, a research done by the University of Cincinnati for ground stormwater management. And it specifies, or one of the options is aggregate, which is limestone or gravel. And again, this is limestone, crushed limestone, not just gravel. And limestone does have the tendency to compact and keep itself intact rather than gravel just being picked up in the tread of your tires and spread through the streets. So we did our best to make things look as it was historically, and it's just part of the historical character of that property. It's kind of a unique property in the township, and we're trying to maintain that.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Any further questions, Mr. Bang?
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, may I ask one other question?
Yeah.
As far as from the, where do we define if it has to be done? From the end of the garage to the barn, can that remain as is, or when will that be determined or defined?
That'll be part of what we want to hear, all of the testimony, and then that'll be part of the debate that we have. It may or may not be germane to the final debate, so we don't, I can't answer your question yet.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Anyone wishing to speak in favor of this action?
Yes, I will. Living here 44 years, knowing his father, buying vegetables and fruits from his father's stand at the old homestead, I think Anderson Township needs to think about keeping some of the structures, some of the flavor of the history of Anderson Township. I speak specifically because we live in former Potter Stewart's mother's home in Anderson Township, which is very, very old. And I am in support of Anderson Township, hoping the zoning committee will agree with the gentleman who's just presented his proposal that the driveway aggregate be kept, because it is in keeping with the old farmhouse style. Thank you.
Thank you. And we have her name and address, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Thompson.
Got it. Got it. Thank you, ma'am. Anyone else wish to speak in favor of this? Yes, sir.
Hi. Robert Jump, 8035 Blackthorn Drive, a neighbor to this property.
Did you swear in at the
yes.
beginning? You did? Thank you.
Yeah. And I would just like to say that in keeping with the historical nature of Anderson Township, I've lived by this property over 10 years. There hasn't been any problem with, you know, dust with this driveway, with gravel getting out in the street. You know, I use the sidewalk in front of that property all the time. I've never noticed any problem with this gravel driveway. And I love the fact that, you know, we have the historical nature of the barns and the property, and I know they tried to keep that intact with the way that they constructed and designed this whole property. And I'm sure if they would have known of this rule or whatever, that it would have greatly affected the way that they would have designed and not been able to kind of keep that historical nature of the property. So I would just like to say, please, you know, vote for keeping the gravel driveway. I think it keeps the history of Anderson Township intact.
Thank you, sir. Questions? No. Thank you, sir. Anyone else wish to speak in favor? Yes, sir. Did we swear you in at the beginning?
Yes, sir? I swore in at the beginning.
Thank you.
My name is Andrew Wilson. I live at 7980 State Road, which is the property immediately to the west of this residence. So I'm the next curb cut up State Road from the school. And I'm in favor of it because one of the reasons why we purchased our piece of property is because of the Red Barn and the historic farmhouse that was there. And I knew Mr. Bang's father, Lou, very well. And it was the community garden, and still is in many ways. And I think one of the things I appreciated most about the transfer of the property to keep in the family was the fact that the way they approached the design of their home and the whole keeping with the spirit of the property. And that was just a part of the nature of the way life was back then. We still dig horseshoes out of the ground in the property from time to time. And when you looked at the house, and we were, Mr. Bank's father lived in the back portion of it because the original farmhouse didn't have running water, electricity, heating and air conditioning or anything like that. So in order to really bring this property back to a livable state for Anderson Township, it was prohibitive. And so they kept the general shape of the property, the elongation of it. They didn't face the house towards the state road the way the house has been added on. So they kind of worked really hard to keep that flavor. And as the next door neighbor, we haven't had any issues in the 11 years that we've lived there, and we built that house next door. I have previous property where I had a limestone driveway, and it, as you drive on it, it crushes down and becomes a really solid surface, and I didn't have any dust issues on my property with the 10 years I had that one, and I haven't observed any in the 11 years I've been here with this driveway either. And to support my neighbor, Mr. Jump, and his assessment that I'm often down the sidewalk as well because we live there, There hasn't been any gravel pushed off of the site into the sidewalk or into the street, and because that's all concrete curbing from that point forward. So it hasn't presented any nuisance to us, and I am not aware of anything that's causing an issue. And as a matter of fact, I appreciate the fact that the property took such great pains to keep it in that original flavor. There's very few of these homes left in our township that reflect the way it was. And so I'm okay with it.
Thank you, sir. Any questions for the... Okay. Anyone else want to speak in favor of this? Seeing none, anyone wish to speak against this action? Seeing none, are there any further questions from the board to anyone? Okay, let's close the public hearing section of case number 10-2016. And the board will now go back to the first case and begin debating the actions one at a time. Let's start with case number 8-2016.
I'll be glad to start here. Regarding request A, which is the variance request for a fence height of 6 feet, this is a replacement of an existing fence. It shades the view into the adjacent service yard. So if there was ever a true case of hardship, I think we have it in front of us here regarding this fence. So, and because it's a replacement, there's all the conditions that we typically talk about the conditions, the standards that we typically consider, I think, are all met by granting the variance request for the fence. Staff has found that the variance is not substantial. The starting point of the fence is 400 feet off Nordyke Road. So regarding request A, I am totally in favor of granting that variance request for those few reasons that I stated, and again because of our standards that we typically review. Request B, the variance request for an existing accessory structure building to be located in the front yard where only one is permitted. I think again we're looking at this when the zoning certificate was issued back in 2002 for the current home, of which that existing garage was to be removed, and that garage has remained for 14 years, and we're talking about the character of the neighborhood, you know, being subjected to some substantial detriment. I just can't see it because it's been there for that long. Again, the depth of the property, the fact that it's a panhandle lot means that that accessory structure is certainly a substantial distance from the street. Again, staff has found that the variance is not substantial, and I just, I am in support of both granting the variance request for request A, the fence height of 6 feet, and the variance request to remain the existing, to let the existing accessory building that's located in the front yard to remain.
Thank you.
I have no further comments, but I concur.
Yeah, I agree with everything that's been said. I have no issue with it.
Yeah, I also agree. I think that's very thoroughly stated. Nice job, Mr. Hamer. I would like to see us put a restriction on what the, since there's nothing in the plans, we should put a restriction in this that it'd be a 6 foot dog eared fence that is dark brown in color. If that meets with everyone's approval. Any further discussion on this one?
Sometimes when we've allowed additions or something that encroach into yards, we've I know in past, we say, okay, there's an accessory structure. One, we typically allow one of a certain size, or we don't prohibit any additional accessory structures with this one located in the front yard. And I say that so we can open up that discussion, and yet I would say that because of the shape of the lot, because of the depth of it, I mean, if they want to put another accessory structure in the backyard, it looks like topography might be a challenge for them. But I just don't see that being a concern here. So I would, again, reiterating my support for granting the variance with the fence condition, with the condition you stated, and then the other condition that it be, you know, set within a year, finished within 2 years, and the style that you mentioned.
I thought you were heading to a further restriction, but
I talked myself out of it.
You were thinking out loud there for a bit. Yeah, to further that, though, I think if that were to
think out loud with me here,
that's what I'm doing, is thinking out loud with you. If that were to come up in the future, that would again come before this board, because it would be an accessory structure that is placed in the front yard.
Yeah.
Technically, anything between the front of the front building line and the road,
yep,
would be technically in the front yard. So it'd come before the board again, and it could be reviewed at that time.
Okay.
So I agree with you talking yourself out of further restrictions.
Anything else?
I don't think so. Have either of you two gentlemen made motions in the past? I missed the last meeting, so I don't know.
No, we've not.
So you're not familiar with it?
No.
We'll have Mr. Haber do the work.
Mr. Chair, regarding case number 8-2016 BZA, I move that we grant variance request A for a fence height of 6 feet and solid in the front yard area where a maximum of 4 feet and 75% open is permitted per Article 5.2A9. And I am, well, let me just say, as a matter of procedure, I want me to do both of these, or just
do both of them.
That the staff has found that the variance is not substantial because the starting point of the fence is approximately 400 feet off Nordyke Road. The essential character of the neighborhood would not be substantially altered, and adjoining properties will not suffer a substantial detriment as the result of the variance. That this is a replacement for a fence of the same height that blocks the view from the subject property and adjoining properties to the rear of Hamilton County Park District building lot, which includes dumpsters and portalettes. Variance is not going to adversely affect the delivery of governmental services. The property owner's predicament really cannot be feasibly obviated through some method other than a variance. Landscaping would not be sufficient in blocking the view of the adjacent property, as we saw in the pictures that were shown during testimony. The spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed, and substantial justice done by granting the variance, because again, the starting point of the fence is located approximately 400 feet off Nordyke Road. In addition to my motion, I add two conditions. One is that it is a 6 feet high dog-eared type fence, dark brown in color, that construction would start within 1 year and be completed within 2 years, and is located in conformance with the plot plan dated August 10th, 2016. In addition, I move that we grant request B, which is a variance request for an existing accessory building to be located in the front yard where one is only permitted in the rear yard per Article 5.2A7. Again, staff finds that the variance is not substantial. The existing garage is located even farther off Nordyke Road, approximately 568 feet, and is located behind a neighboring garage. The essential character of the neighborhood would not be substantially altered, and adjoining structures would not be, adjoining properties will not suffer a substantial detriment as a result of the variance. Again, that structure has been there for some time, and we know, given the documentation, that's been there at least 14 years since the house was built in 2002. The existing garage is partially shielded by a tree line on the north side, located again behind a neighboring garage. It's not going to, the variance will not adversely affect the delivery of governmental services. The property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some method other than this variance. If we do not grant this variance, then that structure comes down. So there isn't any other way, any other thing that we can do except either grant this variance or require the garage to be torn down. Can't be moved to a rear yard, and demolition is going to be costly. Spirit intent behind the zoning requirement would be absurd and substantial justice done by granting the variance. No conditions there.
I need a second.
I second.
Thank you. Any further discussion on that? Very nice job, Mr. Haber.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Not necessarily thinking out loud.
Thank you. You had it all set. You had it all prepped. We have a motion and a second. Would the secretary call the roll, please?
Mr. Hare?
Aye.
Mr. Zine?
Aye.
Ms. Nosel-Levis?
Aye.
And Mr. Hare?
Aye. Now further in there are procedures. You've heard the board debate and reach a resolution. The paperwork on that will not be completed until later, even later. We'll come back and get the official paperwork on each of these actions and then actually sign the documents. And you can pick up the formal action from Paul in the morning for that particular action. And we'll move on to the next case then. Case number 9-2016 BZA. And Paul has a procedure here. You're going to try and do all three of these requests in one, or do you want to split them?
I'm going to
give a preference.
We broke them out as three different requests, in case you had feelings over, you know, one over the other. But all of the criteria overlap, so it's very hard to, you know, break them completely out.
Especially the nice job that you did pulling it all together.
The variance request is only for request A. That's the only variance, but all the criteria, you know.
The rest is conditional use.
Criteria,
yep.
Correct.
Yes. I cut you off, Mr. Haber. What were you starting to say?
Well, I was going to say we ought to look at them individually. Would be a way to go about it. I don't think, so let me go ahead and start as a way to perhaps answer that. Request A, the variance for the pool locations, that is the actual variance request, the 90 feet for the pool and the little less than 80 feet for the kiddie pool shade structure, which looks to me to be somewhat in the same location. I can't necessarily verify that. I believe there was testimony earlier about underground piping, which we have dealt with before regarding septic systems and additions. I haven't heard any testimony against this, that we're basically replacing a pool with a pool. I'm in support of granting the variance. for that. Regarding the conditional use request, then, I've got some real current concerns with the paddleball location. We have testimony here that people have been concerned about it, testimony people in opposition of it. I don't know if we have enough information, and I think staff is, again, you noted that staff quite adequately in their report said more information is needed from the applicant. And I am uncomfortable at this point without any further additional information to grant the conditional use request, because I don't believe we have enough information. In addition, there was the new golf building, which is going to have its lighting and whatnot, that I don't know if we've considered. We looked at the architecture of it, but I think there's going to be some lighting that is going to be included with it that we haven't looked at yet. And I think there was some testimony earlier from there. So regarding, and in addition, finally, there was some concerns about schedule. So I don't see any challenge with granting the variance request for the pools. I am uncomfortable moving forward with anything regarding the paddleball. And the other building until we get some additional information that we can, or that the appellant may be able to go to those people and work out a solution or something that may be able to, they would then come back to us and say that they've been able to resolve the concerns, so we'd be able to then move forward based on whatever additional information they have. So when I said let's separate these, I can go ahead and grant the variance for the pools, but I'm not comfortable with moving forward anywhere yet on the paddleball or the other building yet. And would be able to request that the appellant gather some additional information and continue to talk with the neighbors, that we'd be able to come back next month, open the public hearing back up if we need to for that additional information.
Further thoughts? John?
Can we talk about what additional information we would need? Because I don't know, looking at this, I don't know what else. Maybe I'm unaware what they would provide. They provided the lighting, noise. It'd be hard to actually measure noise without actually having the pickleball court there, or not pickleball, racquetball court there.
Paddleball,
yeah. Sorry. But I'm trying to think of what they could bring us that would be different than what they've already have, other than maybe better arrangements that the next door neighbors might like better. That's the only thing I can think of.
That would be number one to hope for, is that they work out a substantial solution that works for them.
Well, one possibility, from a process standpoint, I generally try to stay out of the debates until the final motion is made. And that's why I'm last to ask questions and everything, so I should explain that to you too. And I was doing that here, but to your point, what additional information here? I think there is some confusion about the complaints of noisy recreation sports here, and the confusion between paddle tennis and pickleball. Pickleball is fairly well known. I'm a player, as being very loud. It's a messy noise. None of the neighbors like it, and so there are a lot of complaints nationwide about it. And I think there's some overlap between that and this particular sport, paddle tennis, where We heard the testimony from the builder of the courts that they've never had any complaints about the noise. I think further clarification of the separation between where the concerns are, what sport is creating the complaints, would go a long way towards easing this, I think, in addition to Mr. Haver's thoughts about negotiation with the, in particular with the Thompsons. Mr. and Mrs. Thompson would probably go a long way towards reconciling differences and clarifying for us what we would need. Those are the two things that I think would go along with your request for more information and clarify your question.
Okay.
Yeah, because either we're going to deny it tonight because of what information we have, or can we ask, you know, and I don't think that we're designers at all. We are only responding to what we've been given. So can the professionals and the residents get together and come up with a satisfactory solution, and we give them that time now that those grievances and concerns have been aired? So I mean, if I got a force tonight, I'm going to say no. Otherwise, I'll give them whatever time they need to go back to the drawing board, so to speak, and make sure that all these concerns can be taken care of. That's my thinking.
Now, the consideration there is that the timing on the paddle tennis courts is the one that is most pressing. Mm-hmm. The timing, any delay on the golf training facility wouldn't matter, because they need the time anyhow. They don't want to start within
right.
a year.
Right.
So delaying the conditional use on that would not be a problem at all.
Right.
Yep.
I'd like to make a comment on with regards to the indoor golf facility. With lighting, I see that mainly as all the lighting would be indoor. There might be some path lighting, so I don't know that there's going to be that much issue with lighting compared to the pickleball court or the paddle tennis court. So I'm not sure I'm as uncomfortable with the indoor golf range.
I agree with you. I am not, but there's going to be some building light to it, security lighting or something, and I want to make sure that we know what that is. At least I do. I want to know what that is.
I know you said the pool was something that was critical to get in the ground. Is that something we could approve today? And that way you could at least get that started.
That's why I said, let's separate them so we can go, because again, I'm in favor of A, that we can grant that one and then table the other two and leave that up to the appellant to provide us additional information and work out any concerns that the neighbors might have. That's why I would take action on A, and we don't really need to take any action on the other two, except to
request for the further information.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep. Okay. Further thoughts, discussion before we formulate a motion? Okay, then, and I agree with splitting them too. So let's proceed with two separate motions, one at a time.
Okay.
I will take a crack at it. Okay, Mr. Chair, in regarding case number 9-2016 BZA at Coldstream Country Club, 400 Asbury Road, I move that we grant the variance request for a new swimming pool with attached diving area, detached baby pool, and associated shade structure, and relocate the existing children's play area. This is known as Request A. I move that we grant
the pool location to be 90.76 feet setback and 79.49 feet for the kiddie pool shade structure, where 100 feet from the property line is required. And under this variance, this is Article 5.4HD, 100-foot setback for all structures. The staff finds that the variance is not substantial. The existing kiddie pool shade structure, playset, and basketball courts range in setback of 63 to 72 feet from Ayers Road. All proposed new construction is setback at least 80 feet from Ayers Road. Essential character of the neighborhood is not going to substantially be altered, in adjoining properties will not suffer a substantial detriment as a result of this variance. Again, this is the pool location variance. The proposed pool and associated structures are to replace an older pool with associated structures essentially in the same area, however, with a greater setback. Variance is not going to adversely affect the delivery of governmental services. Property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some method other than granting this variance. We talked earlier about the dimensional variances result from the existing underground pool equipment that would remain as part of this project as being a reason, the location of the pools. The spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed and substantial justice done by granting this variance. The variance will allow the 50-year-old pool to be upgraded in the same general location, allowing continued use of the pool house fencing and other existing structures. Conditions. Conditions include, in conformance with the drawings dated August 12th, 2016, and then I'm going to put a timing restriction on it, and I do not remember the testimony regarding timing, because typically it's starts within one and within two. If that's still good?
For the pool, I think that's good.
Well, then construction will start within 1 year and be completed within 2 years.
I second the motion.
Thank you. Further discussion? Seeing none, we have a motion and a second on the floor. Will the secretary call the roll, please?
Mr. Hinton?
Aye.
Mr. Zahn?
Aye.
Mr.
Zolovich? Aye.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so with this, the other two requests, a decision was made on request A. On request B and C, the case was technically closed. So do you wish to, the three options here, you can request just additional information and keep the case closed, which means no additional testimony from either side. You can reopen that portion of the case, still ask for additional information, but that would allow for public testimony from all sides. Those are really the two options, since you're...
Well, I thought you said there was three.
The other one is, yes, you're right. The other one would just be to deny it altogether, and I don't think that was your decision, so you're right. Two choices. So either continue, and you've requested specific information, but that allows them to submit that information, but no further testimony, or you can reopen that portion of the case and continue it till the next.
There's still the possibility that it's fully denied here after further discussion, but the other two options are for the next meeting, if and when we come back. There's an option to just examine the requested information and not reopen the public hearing, or we have an option of reopening the public hearing.
I think you need to reopen it now, because you technically closed it for deliberation, but you only decided on one of the requests.
Yes.
So we need to either reopen it now and go ahead and request that additional information be submitted for the next hearing.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. The public hearing for case number 9-2016 BZA 400 Asbury Road Coldstream Country Club is hereby reopened for a board debate and a proposed action.
Do we need a motion on that to include public testimony if we're going to open the public hearing?
If it's open, it's open. But and you're okay. Requesting, okay, that's really all that we need is just to reopen.
So
okay.
Don't wait until next meeting. Reopen it now, and I just
okay.
did.
Okay. Okay. Right. So are we looking for a motion then to
continue? It would be continue.
To continue the
request
the two requests.
B and C. Yes.
Okay. Mr. Chair, regarding case number 9-2016 BZA, I move that we continue request B.
And request C.
And request C. I was going to call them out, but I move that we continue those request from the applicant additional information as well as effort to resolve concerns with the neighbors. I'm not quite sure if I worded that very well. I think the information has been noted on staff's report where existing is additional information is needed. I mean, we're looking at noise, we're looking at light, and how that may be, how that'll affect the neighbors. So I'm thinking out loud and not doing very well.
Keep going.
I move that we continue request B, request C, and ask for additional information from the appellant and continued effort to resolve neighbors' concerns.
Regarding lighting and noise?
Yes.
Anything else? Those are the two main issues, right?
Right.
Okay. Further thoughts, discussions?
Nothing further. I second.
That's right. You made that motion.
I did.
I shouldn't have been stepping in that way. Thank you. Any further discussion on the motion? I have a clarifying a question on the motion.
Okay.
Is that we did receive testimony on several agreed restrictions. We want to retain them. We don't want to lose them and re-debate them next
right.
next time.
Right.
The issue is strictly on the noise raised by paddle tennis and the lighting restrictions in both the paddle tennis area and the practice golf area.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right. Paul, did you get those? Thank you. Perfect.
We have a motion, somewhat clarified, but I think we agree, and a second. The second still exists?
It
good.
Does.
Thank you. Would the Secretary of Police call the roll?
Mr. Hayward?
Aye.
Mr. Zion?
Aye.
Mr.
Aye.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye. And follow-up action on that. Are you okay with the follow-up action on that one with the appellants? Okay. Thank you. Moving to our last case for tonight, case number 10-2016. Let's see if Mr. Haber can go second or third. I'm trying to give you a break and trying to give you some practice. Thoughts?
I'm looking at this case. You know, coming from a legal perspective, ignorance of the law is no excuse, but then there is an equity case to be argued that this driveway has been in existence for a long time now, and even when the inspectors came out and looked at it, they didn't say anything about it. And then we've got another case that we heard today too, where, you know, we're not asking somebody to tear down a garage because it's been in existence for 20 years. So I do have some issues with, you know, forcing somebody to pave a driveway when we didn't tell them ahead of time that, hey, you needed to do this.
Just looking at it from a pure architectural standpoint, I think your driveway does meet what the intent is, and it's been there for a while. And from a financial standpoint, it's a long driveway, and I think I'm in agreement. I think it could probably stay.
Yeah. Ditto. yeah, I'm in agreement. I think there was another driveway that we looked at down on Kellogg, and I don't remember what that was. Where we allowed it to remain gravel for a portion of it. And I think the reasons why, because we weren't in, there weren't a lot of neighbor, there weren't a lot of residential properties, even though I think it was in a residential area. And we granted that one. And one of the things I argued at the time was stormwater. I certainly understand the need to pave it from a residential point of view, that, you know, in my, where I live, I think it's appropriate to have everybody to have their driveway paved. Here we've got, I don't know, it's almost kind of a rural application, even though it's within a suburb, where to me it makes a lot of sense that we allow this to remain gravel. Stormwater concerns, we've just seen a bunch of rain events happen. Cost, and the equity notion that was brought up, the more rural, and I really appreciated the comment before about the historical nature. I did. I really appreciated those comments before. That they're so. I, for those reasons, I'm in favor of granting the variance request as well.
I'd say for me, one other thing was the intent is definitely clear. You kept the house the same orientation, and you didn't. You didn't change the site dramatically, so and it's in your family. So, if this was a new development, a new owner that just wanted to keep the driveway, I think it'd be clear. But it seems like the intent has always been to keep it.
Technically, Jan, and by next meeting, I'll know your last name and be able to call you by Mr. But the debate now is strictly between us.
Okay.
It has nothing to do with the appellant or the audience or anybody else.
Gotcha.
In the audience. Actually, I'm torn on this one more than you folks seem to be. Although your comment of ignorance is no excuse, or no, I tried to look for some excuse of ignorance, and it's not there. It is just not there. But I was equally swayed by the historical comments of keeping the unique nature of this site and the rural feel of the site in place. I thought that I would be debating on where the line of demarcation is between the required pavement and the allowable extension to the barn, but I'm swayed, I think, with the rest of you, that we probably ought to grant this variance and let it remain as is. So I'm with you.
Okay.
Now, in terms of a motion, Mr. Hayward made two here tonight that were admittedly tough. All of these motions are tough. They are complicated. But the issue that we really want to cover is that as staff puts in the summary, the standards to be considered, and they're clicked off there. And we want to give reasons on each one of those considerations, those standards, of why we are acting the way that we propose that we act. So that's the logic and the reason and the structure behind the motion. With that, yeah, I'm encouraging one of you two to take a shot at it, but if you're still uncomfortable, we'll go back and lean on the
I'll be glad to.
Professional.
We'll let the pro do it.
Perfect. Mr. Chair, in regarding case number 10-2016 BZA at 8008 State Road, I move that we grant a variance request for a crushed limestone driveway to remain where a solid surface is required per Article 5.3D7A. And there have been a number of things that we have talked about here tonight in addition to our standards, including that this property is more rural in nature because of its farm application, that historically the driveway has remained for a number of years, and we've had testimony from adjacent property owners that the existing limestone driveway neither creates dust nor does it spill down into the public right-of-way. That there is to require now the appellant to pave it comes at a substantial cost, which might have altered the design of the house had the requirement for the pavement of the driveway known when they first designed the house. So there was that ignorance and equity question that was talked about before, and I'm moving towards equity. I do not believe that the variance is substantial. The essential character of the neighborhood is not substantially altered, and adjoining properties would not suffer substantial detriment if we leave the driveway as is, because it's been that way for a number of years. It's not going to adversely affect delivery of governmental services. We talked about the equity situation, that the property owner's predicament cannot be feasibly obviated through some method other than a variance to pave this. Is a substantial financial consideration. The spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement is observed, and substantial justice is done by granting the variance. And I believe there are no conditions on it, since we're just saying that the limestone can remain as is.
I second the motion.
Any further discussion? May I offer a semi-friendly amendment for both of your considerations? You said that the variance is not substantial. I would propose that we amend that to be that the variance is substantial, but the other considerations outweigh this. And what I'm worried about there, to further explain that one, is that I don't want this to be a precedent that we can quickly approve, or we're fine with gravel driveways when staff is really requiring any substantial modification to the property, they include an upgrade to that driveway. I don't want this to be a precedent going the other way.
Okay. Yeah.
You're okay with that?
Mm-hmm. I am.
And you're second? You're still okay?
Still, yeah.
Okay. Yep.
We have a motion and a second on the table. Would the secretary please call the roll?
Mr. Haber?
Aye.
Mr. Sines?
Aye.
Mr. Nonaluzzi?
Aye.
Mr. Fain?
Aye. Thank you all. And again, the formal paperwork will be ready for the positive actions in the morning, if you want it that quickly. Okay, then next week sometime. It won't take long. But we're here for a while, though, finishing up the final paperwork.
Thank you.
Do you want to take a recess?
We will take a recess. Microphone's on.
Yep.
We are back from recess and ready to formalize the first case is 8-2016.
I'm going to make an aside comment here. Request B, a variance request for an existing accessory building to located in the front yard where one is only permitted in the rear yard. Is that true?
Mm-hmm.
No.
That's not true.
It's implied to say where an accessory structure is only permitted. You can have more than one accessory structure.
Okay.
The one is a pronoun for an accessory structure.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Not the number.
Thank you.
Correct.
Yeah.
I can put where accessory structures are only.
No. Okay. I read it wrong.
It's easily misread, though. I agree with you. Can you move up just a little bit? I didn't finish the yet. That's good, right there. Go ahead, that's good. If everybody else is.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand that first sentence. Maximum accessory structure size. We're talking about the fence, right?
Okay, yeah, whoop. That's good, right there.
This narrow width directly contributes to the calculation used to determine the maximum. I think that's got to come out. Right. Yes, sir. Yep.
It's August 10th. Yeah. They're all stamped the same, August 10th. Request B.
Yep, I'm good.
Scroll down a little bit more.
Mr., if unless there's anything else.
I wanted to take a look at that final paragraph and draw Mr. Nasilovich's attention to that. See the first couple of words there? Mm-hmm. Or first couple of lines, sorry. That this board hereby finds and determines that all formal actions of this board concerning and relating to this passage were taken in open meetings. So we're swearing to that here now.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, in the case, case 8-2016 BZA, I move we approve and journalize the case.
Second motion.
We have a any discussion? We have a motion and a second on the floor. Secretary, call the roll, please.
Mr.
Henry? Aye.
Mr. Zion?
Aye.
Mr.
Aye.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Sweet.
Boy.
And Betty, that's Nasilovich. Nasilovich.
Nasilovich or Nasilovich?
Nasilovich.
Nasilovich.
Nasilovich. Nasilovich. Betty Nasilovich. Nasilovich. Just over and over.
That's what I'm doing. Something, I don't know where else you're going here, Paul, but something doesn't read right there. I don't know what the rest of it's going to say. We want to grant request A and continue request B and C. So the paragraph there, being fully advised and from the evidence adduced at the hearing in this case, the board hereby determines that it would not be contrary to the public interest, health and safety to authorize the issuance of a special zoning certificate for conditional use.
Can we put request A in here again?
Well, that request A is a variance though, right?
It's also, request A is for conditional use and a variance.
So that paragraph really refers to request A.
Mm-hmm. I can put request A in here again.
Yeah, let's do that.
I think that would work better.
Let's do that. Because, yeah, once we said something about B and C. Yeah, good.
Just so we're clear, it is a little unusual. And
To take the two separate actions?
Well, to keep them under the same case number, although, you know, I know they want to move forward with the pool and it didn't seem there was any, so.
We should be able to write this correctly.
I think so.
I think we're okay.
You see your request C, you might want to make that a bigger font size to match the others.
That's all reduced because of the italics, I think.
Perfect.
Oh, you copied all of this in then from the from your staff summary?
Yes, and what I changed, the ones that we felt that we needed more information, I took those out and I said compliant for the pool. And then the next time that you hear request B and C, there will be different reasons for those.
Oh, okay.
This is making good sense now. So let's see D. What'd you say on D?
Well, it kept it as the variance request. For the
That's fine.
Setbacks.
That's fine. Good.
And then
L is the next one.
L, you changed to compliant.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So we're only talking about the pool.
Mm-hmm. N's compliant, there's no fences.
And then S.
I put S, no lighting is proposed for the pool area.
Super.
And then I changed Y to the location of proposed structured pool, shade structures. I could take out this one. I guess it's the proposed pool's shade structure.
Mm-hmm.
Just take out structure, yeah. That's it.
So pools,
shade, structure.
And shade structure are located. And then here's your variance criteria.
Mm-hmm.
Which I didn't really change much, as I don't know if the motion changed much for the variance.
No, the inclusion of the setbacks are going to be better than existing was an important addition, though, and that motion did have that in there, so that's good.
Sorry, Betty just pointed out I did not put in the conditions.
August 12th.
It's a small keyboard.
There's probably more further down. So it's simple enough to say on the request B and C that it's continued. That's because that's all we've said on them, right?
Yes.
Okay. You okay?
Mm-hmm. Yep. You ready? So is this, is this approved and journalized?
Mr. Chair, in the case of, in regards case number 9-2016 BZA, I move we approve and journalize the decision.
Second.
We've got a motion and a second on the floor. Secretary, call the roll, please.
Mr. Hader?
Aye.
Mr. Zion?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And the last one.
Sorry, the formatting is different. I can change the formatting to the others.
In what way?
Just the
paragraphing?
Yeah, I didn't realize. We had to start from scratch on this one, so.
Fourth line, Anderson Township Board of Zoning Appeals grant a variance request to allow variance request. Thank you. That the variance is substantial. I thought that was just a really nice addition to characterizing this in light of, so we don't get a bunch of gravel driveways.
That was the intent, yes.
Yeah, I thought that was dead on.
I should have asked you for some help there, though. You agree with that?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. I would have thought that you would have.
There are a lot of long driveways in the township.
Yeah.
Number five. The spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed and justice would not be done by granting the variance. We are granting the variance, though, in this case.
Yeah, we want to scratch not. Right where your cursor is, yep. One more delete.
Looks good.
And the wording at the end of number four there is important, too. It may have also altered the design of the new home if they really taken that into consideration. Mm-hmm. That's good.
Mm-hmm. We need a motion on this one. I'm going to be 10 for 10 here.
Are the, yeah, the rest of it is all boilerplate?
Yeah.
Yes.
Mr. Chair, regarding case 10-2016 BZA, I move that we approve and journalize our decision.
Second.
And we have a motion and a second on the floor. The secretary call the roll, please.
Mr. Hader?
Aye.
Mr. Zion?
Aye.
Mr. Robles?
Aye.
Mr. Hayes?
Aye.
Good job.
Thank you all. Now you two can leave. We are done. Although we leave.
Fred,
yeah. And, yeah, the meeting is hereby adjourned.